Good morning. Welcome to 1111 Downtown in Fort Worth. I'm Tom McDermott, the leader and pastor of the 1111 community and one of the associate pastors at First United Methodist Church. So glad that you've decided to join with us this morning. Take a minute, register your attendance, and if you're visiting with us, especially glad you're here, and we'd love to send you something, so give us the pertinent information. We have a gift for you. Listen, Linda McDermott has a book group happening in a week or so on July the 9th, Thursday. They'll be studying, they'll be talking about the book Gilead. Check online, find out more information about that. Also, I think coming up there, you'll see something about our Crafting Difficult Conversations with Daryl Parker and myself. Find more information about what that's going to be about, and we'll be doing that every Monday. It's something new we're doing just in this time that we're in, so hope you can participate with that. Brad Thompson's coming up with a song in just a minute. We're glad that you're with us. Sharm's going to kick us off with our welcome candle. So good to have you with us this morning.
Hi, everybody. I want to add my welcome and my hello. Brad and Tom and I are always talking about how much we miss you guys. This week, as we were talking and planning this time together, we thought about the welcome candle and how much we miss those lovely words that we said together so many times. You know, those words, repeating them week after week, helped to shape us and form us as a community. And so here it is, broad daylight, and we don't really need the candle, but we do need the words. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, it doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times, come yet again.
To the east, to the west, love people never gonna stop.
Never gonna stop.
to the east, to the west, to the north and south, to the east, to the west. One love, people never gonna stop. This whole thing seems upside down. The whole wide world keeps turning around. This whole thing seems upside down. The whole wide world keeps turning around. This whole thing seems upside down. The whole wide world keeps turning around. This whole thing seems upside down.
Living in this world is messy. We are each so complicated, so opinionated, so full of insecurities that we really don't want to admit to. And so we get tangled up in each other's feelings and in our own feelings. We have a hard time hearing what people are saying or what they're trying to say. We have a hard time seeing it when we're wrong and saying it when we do see it. And so we argue and we fight. Yes, we love, but we argue and we fight some more. May we somehow return again and again to the surprising joy of thinking about us and not always just me. May we never give up on looking for a way forward, for trying to live in peace, and seeking the common good. Amen.
Hey everyone, good morning, and it's good to be with you again. So great to have you with us this morning as we finish up our series. I want to say, first of all, thank you, Charm. It was a great prayer.
Beautiful.
And appreciate that. And also Brad and the band, awesome job on that Michael Fronte song, From the East to the West. We are all grounded in love, no matter what side of the picture we're on. We are all grounded. This is this speaks to what we're talking about.
Yeah,
and so we've been talking about this for 5 to 6 weeks. You, Linda McDermott, Reverend Linda McDermott's back with me.
Yeah, for the sixth week, I think. And you've been at this
We've been at this
11
17 weeks, I think. It's just nuts.
Wow, this who would have known?
It's a different reality.
Wow. Yeah. Well, so, and you know what? It means a lot to us that you are here. You've been sending in emails and text, and it's been really inspiring the way you've looked at these parables and allowed them to give you a different lens to see the world.
Yeah.
And what they're sending in is
such a great insight.
Yeah, thank you.
So keep it coming.
Keep it up. That's wonderful.
And the theme of this series has been
Disruptions, parables
for the pandemic. Because parables speak to this sort of being broken open. They break us open. They're intended to. And this time that we're in has had this sort of effect on us that is really revealing a lot that's going on. And so this what we've been talking about and constantly, maybe too often, saying, but it's this idea that the parables speak to what Jesus called the kingdom of God has really been this idea of shalom.
Shalom.
Which in Hebrew is peace, but it's not simply peace.
If they don't know this by now.
Yes, I know.
Shalom.
It is
peace. Unity,
harmony,
right relationships,
and justice.
Justice.
Which is kind of right relationship, but it's this with all things, with one another, with strangers.
Kingdom
with,
of God.
It's all inclusive. It's this balance. It's this path that we live into in all of our moments. And that's the challenge that these parables remind us. Are we doing that?
Okay.
So
we came up with two questions.
Yes, that's right. And this is what we're going to cover.
Oh, I forgot.
Yeah, well, I've started this habit now.
I'm going to count.
So very quickly.
You're going to try to have 10. Let me see.
Two important questions.
Okay.
Let us repeat ourselves.
No.
That's two, yeah. That's not fair, or is it? Your soul is about relationship. Let's count some sheep. I think we'll skip that one today. We're not going to do what's count sheep, so I'm only going to do 9. But what about him? This thing is thousands of years old. The most human behavior you've ever seen.
That's a good one.
We'll have a few takeaways. Mm-hmm. And then finally, we're going to get a word from the late poet laureate Maya Angelou. Yeah.
9
things.
Because
time.
We skipped one.
Well, we're going to skip that one. So these parables have been about opening up us up to change the way we see things. And what did Richard Rohr call that?
The change that changes everything.
Because it literally, these parables invite us mm-hmm. to see this interdependent, grounded in love way of being in the world. Mm-hmm. And it changes everything when we see it that way.
Once we get there.
So the first question that we'd ask as a part of this series is, are you any different? Mm-hmm. 6 weeks ago, would you look at yourself now and think in the way in terms of which we think about the world, the way we see the world now, are mm-hmm. we any different?
Are you different?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good one. The second question is,
do you see a way forward that you wouldn't have seen or couldn't have seen 6 weeks ago?
Are you different? Can you see a way forward that you couldn't have seen 6 weeks ago?
And we're going to come back to those questions when we look at each of the parables very quickly, but Linda's going to give us a quick repeat on parables.
Just some ways to look at the parables. Yeah. So first, we have to get the right framework for hearing them. So even though they have meaning for us today, it's important for us to recover the original meaning. What did the Jewish peasants and others who were hearing Jesus' parables, what did they hear then? So we want to be careful to jump immediately to Christian, post-resurrection, early church influence, and go back to what did the original people hear when Jesus said these parables? Mm-hmm. And second, understand that these parables, I think you said it, are intended to shock you. They mm-hmm. are intended to make you go,
well, they're intended to shock their listeners.
Shock the original listeners, and we got to find out why them, and then allow it to do that to us.
Right.
Somehow, because if it's too tame, then we've probably missed.
Amy Jill Levine, the scholar we've often referred to, said that if you're not uncomfortable when you hear these, then we're probably not hearing them right.
Yeah, we've softened them way too much. They're meant to confront, and then the third thing. We need to see these parables in the light of Jesus' overall teachings. So most of Jesus' teachings were about the kingdom of God, which we have said really defines itself as shalom. And so if we ask ourselves in every parable, how is this parable talking about shalom? If we've not allowed that to be a part of it, then we're probably a little bit, we've steered away from the meaning of the parable for them and for us.
Yeah.
And again, they just don't always have one meaning. So we can continue to let these speak then, but also speak now. So those are just a real brief run through of some things we need to keep in mind when we look at parables.
So the question then, are we
different?
Any different? And do we see a way forward because of these parables? Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we tried to do as we looked at these parables is seen them in a different light.
Right. And so for me, mm-hmm. I know the most difficult parable for me was the parable of the generous vineyard owner. Because as a person who comes from the Western world, the Western society, my perspective on fairness is pretty well developed. It's not fair. It needs to be fair. Mm. But in this case, things weren't fair to begin with.
Mm. They didn't seem right. They didn't seem fair to the workers, that's for sure.
And in fairness terms, it wasn't. But was it right? Now, remember, nobody was cheated.
Right.
Nobody was lied to. The only difference is that the vineyard owner decided to be generous because of whatever he desired.
It says at the end of the parable, who are you to complain about my generosity?
Exactly.
Yeah. What does that say?
And what Amy
Shalom?
Jill Levine says, everybody wins. Everybody went home that night with food for their family. And that was cause for celebration.
Everybody wins if they see the reality is about everybody.
Right. So everybody should have celebrated.
If they say, the reality is only about me,
then
I should have got what I wanted. And that wasn't fair. I mean, if we see it, that's the problem that we run into, and that's the problem that I had with the next parable.
Okay.
Was not seeing it, that it's about everybody.
Okay.
Right? Because the next parable was the parable of the man who was about to lose his soul, the farmer who stockpiled up everything in the warehouses.
His soul
and
is required.
And then this very
nature,
soul is required, which, as an evangelical, you know, I always heard that.
I always heard it as,
if
you die tonight, where is your soul?
Where's your soul going to go?
Where are you going to go?
Yeah. And what we should be saying...
What?
What has your soul... Where has your soul been all this time?
Ah.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Do you know where your soul is? Because that's really what he'd lost. He
Shalom
literally
requires.
Had lost his soul.
That's
had lost
it.
His connection with
Shalom.
Others.
Right
relationship. He was completely out of right relationship. Everything stockpiled when everything should have been spread around.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's, again, that's the vineyards. That's the stockpiling. It's this right relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Are you in right relationship? That's what your soul is.
Yeah. We did the, I know, the man in the ditch, which is a little different take because we know it as the Good Samaritan.
Mm-hmm.
But the man in the ditch offers us a whole different perspective. We're looking at it from his point of view, and he's the one who's vulnerable. And here comes his enemy. Everybody else has passed him by, but his enemy, and is he going to kill me? Is he not? And so what Martin Luther King said about that, that I thought was so powerful, was the first two people who passed by said, "What's going to happen to me if I help him?" They responded out of fear.
Right.
The third one said, "What's going to happen to him if I don't?" That's a response of shalom.
That whole idea of fear is so
interconnected.
Right, it is. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So he got it.
And that whole idea of motivated by fear has been something that we've talked about throughout all of these series, is that this basic biology that we experience, that we have, that puts us in these places of fear, and we respond out of fear. So we stockpile, or we do, or we get defensive about what's ours and what isn't ours, and we should
have more.
And Jesus is constantly saying, the parables remind us it's not about us; it's about being connected with others.
It's,
and when that happens, when that's the motivation, shalom is the path. Then everything's in right relationship. All things work together for good.
That's sustainable.
That's that Romans passage that I love, that we talked about at the very beginning. So throughout history, this has been a pattern.
Right.
If you look at the Jewish history, at Israel's history, go back to the Old Testament,
the
Book of Kings, and the prophets, they were always saying, it gets out of perspective. It gets out of balance. You have the top couple of percent, the rulers and the media people connected to the rulers, the Pharaoh or the kings,
in power.
Even Solomon when he married the Pharaoh's daughter, and then stockpiling and building the forts that the Pharaoh had given him. It was all about defending that top percentage.
Right.
And then what happens? The majority start to fall into poverty, or they start to fall into
the gap.
The gap
is huge.
It just gets bigger and bigger, and that is not sustainable.
Right.
And we're talking 5,000, 4,000 years ago, and we're talking today, right? We're talking today.
Over and over, we keep getting the message that kind of disparity is unsustainable.
It's unsustainable.
And the parables remind us that shalom is the path to sustainability.
Yeah. It's so hard to get our head around that vision.
It sure is.
And so we end up, what happens is we end up coming to these tipping points again.
Oh, man.
And I think that's what we're
seeing.
We repeat
over and over.
We're seeing that same tipping point that's been there for thousands of years.
Yes.
We're seeing it now.
It's been coming for a couple of years. When anger, frustration, and hopelessness get to a certain point, that's a tipping point. And it feels to me like we're sort of teetering on that, or have been. But now it feels like it's about ready to slide.
And
the danger is we can respond to it in positive and healing and progressive ways, or we can go...
Just go back to our basic biology.
Well, we can fight
That's
it
what
out.
Happens.
And there will be a lot of bloodshed and violence.
Yeah, we go back to fear and violence. And so
we have a video.
We saw this interesting video. You may have seen this.
I'm going to set it up while you do
But it's Jeffrey, was it Robinson?
Jeffrey Robinson.
Robinson, a lawyer with the ALCU back in 2017. Series of videos.
ACLU.
I don't know what I just said.
ACLU. I don't either.
But he said... he was doing these presentations, and they're great videos to check out, but this one in particular was so illuminating. And he had been at a conference, and down in Indiana, or down in the southern part of the states, and it was a conference dealing with lawyers who have to deal with violent torture.
People who've
people
been tortured.
Victims of torture.
Or prolonged oppression.
Oppressiveness. And the presenter was just giving one image after another, image after another story, and Jeffrey Robinson said it got so intense, and he was just like, I need to find the door.
Yeah.
And then she came up at the end, a woman from Indiana, and she said, I have one last little video clip to show you that I think will show you what I believe is the most human behavior I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
And then she showed this clip. Now, we're going to go a couple of minutes into it.
Right. It's about 8 minutes, so we're only going to show about 2 minutes of it. But where we're coming in, this is filmed by a safari group, and they are filming a pride of lions who have attacked or singled out a calf from a herd of water buffalo.
Right.
And the little calf has run down into the water. They're getting it and they're dragging it back out. The rest of the herd has fled because they're scared.
Yeah.
And just when you think nothing can get worse, and they're dragging this little calf, it's, oh, I hate watching it. A crocodile comes up and grabs the, and there's this tug of war between them. The crocodile finally lets go. The lions drag it back up to the land.
It's this hopeless situation.
And that's where we're going to pick it up, is when they have just finished dragging it away from the
crocodile.
And we're
not going to be listening to the safari participants right now, because we'll have a few comments.
Okay, here it is.
So this is where they've got the calf on the ground. We're not sure if the calf is alive or dead at this point, but suddenly, water buffalo do the unthinkable. They turn around and come back.
And the guide said, while he's watching this, he is shocked, because he said, "What are they doing? I have never seen anything like this ever."
They're coming back to not just one lion, but a pride of lions.
Look at them. I mean, they are.
And so they just, you know, it's almost as if they don't know what to do either, because, again, they've not ever done this.
There goes one of the lions trying to scare them away, and they're huddling up.
It's clear the calf is in danger. The calf is being hurt, is in danger, and they're just huddling. And then, you kind of see some are getting scared.
Whoa.
One of them starts to chase off one of the lions.
Got that one lion.
And then watch
he do.
Now, what's important here is you're watching basic animal, you know, behavior, but one broke away to do something unthinkable.
That's the predator. That's the prey going after the predator.
Going after the predator.
And that's dangerous. That
so
was
now,
so dangerous.
If you watch the lions, they're not really doing anything either. They're all sort of in this place they've never been before, almost.
Well, they watched their buddy get horned.
So then, we'll see another one come out here, right there.
Somebody say, oh, that...
Again.
Oh, that's...
So now all of them are incited. Now they're all responding, and they're chasing them off in two different directions.
Yeah, the other one went the other way. So there's only, I think, two left now. And they're getting really brave. Why are they taking these risks?
But you'll notice they didn't all leave. A bunch of them came back now.
Back.
Now they've all been, you know, because they operate off of herd mentality.
Mm-hmm.
So now they have a whole different orientation to their predator. Now
they've reached a tipping point. That's right. And they've noticed we have some power here. And they're coming in really close. Oh, they get the calf. I can't believe that calf's alive.
The calf is actually still alive, right?
There's the two left. And they're looking... The predator now looks very afraid.
Yeah. Yeah. It's... So we'll stop it here. But basically what happens is that they continue to chase them off. And then the lions go off in the distance. But what she had said was, this is the most human behavior she had ever seen, because just when it seemed hopeless, the most unthinkable has happened and the pack has gone, that's when they try to do something anyway, which has not been done before.
Right. Because somehow this little calf crying, it was enough. It was like, we've had enough. When anger and frustration and hopelessness reach the point of, I can't take this anymore, that's the tipping point.
Mm-hmm.
And the truth is, they acted, those lions could have hurt some of the adults. It was not necessarily going to be a success.
Yeah.
But they took the risk anyway.
So she's saying this is the most human behavior, because you see this tipping point in people's behavior. And what he was suggesting in 2017, this was happening after the violence in Charlottesville and after Michael Brown's death in Missouri. And these things have been happening in 2017. Excuse me, he's doing these presentations.
Right.
And he's saying we're at 3 or 4% of the top are owning the majority of the wealth, and 85 and 90% at the bottom.
And it's even worse.
And now it's even, the disparity is even greater.
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying we reached this tipping point.
Mm-hmm.
And then we've had this pandemic, which begins to break us open. And the reality is it's hard to know which way things will go at these points. But the reality is that there is still a tipping point.
We
that
know
happens.
Something will happen. And if we've learned anything through history, we've learned that to follow the path of shalom is the way toward...
Well,
that's what we're going to be healed.
It's what D.K. Chesterton once said. I was telling you this the other day. He says, because you were saying, we know what the path is. And I'm thinking, well, no, we really don't know what the path is. We've always tried law
Maybe
and
we
order
don't
from
like
a perspective
it.
Of strength versus, you know, weakness.
Right, right.
And we've never tried the path
the
of peace
down.
And shalom.
Right.
We've never really... G.K. Chesterton said, it's not that Christianity has been tried and found wanting. He says it's that Christianity hasn't been tried yet. I think that's the quote. I may have gotten it off a little bit, but that's essentially what he says. It's not that it's found lack and wanting. It's the fact that it's not really ever been tried. Because Jesus' path was really this path of, it's visionary, it's aspirational.
Yes.
It is so aspirational, it's so idealistic.
But we have to,
but if you just think of your own family, what makes the family system work when it's broken is that you all get in there and you all address it.
We were talking about family systems one of the other weeks, and the truth is about family systems, you can bring the troubled child in, but a family therapist is never going to say, I'm going to fix that child. The family therapist is going to say, I'm going to fix this system. Nobody may be doing anything wrong or bad. It's just not working. Mm-hmm. There may have never been anything but loving intent, but you've got to be brave enough to say, what is my role in this system? And we need to do that now. Last week, why now, white people?
Right,
and I think
right.
it's because white people are beginning to say, I'm willing to say that even though I didn't think I had any evil intent, I still played a role. Whether I intended to or not, I have to recognize my role.
This group that you were working with today, that you were teaching, they were coming to that kind of
consensus. Oh my gosh, they were just being so open.
What we have
not
seen, and now what we know, now what do we do next? And of course, that's the thing. Now what do we do next? I mean, we really do. I mean, our takeaways from this is that clearly when we see oppressiveness or when we see this kind of violence, we need to address it. Clearly we need to address hunger and homelessness, and we need to address these things. But systemically, we're like that Rumi poem, we need to sit and listen. We're at the edge and we're all kind of thinking we know, but we're discovering we didn't know or we haven't known.
Right.
Well, we haven't paid enough attention, and so now we need to walk this together.
And like the parable, we can't fall back on things like, well, that's not fair.
Mm-hmm.
We have to lean toward compassion over fairness. We
generosity.
Have to lean toward generosity versus deserving
And even versus protecting our own.
Protecting
our
own
stuff. I mean, for that matter, we need to, it was like one of our friends was saying, like, okay, if my kid's going to get pulled over by an officer, I need to be able to say that's my, if your kid's getting pulled over, I should say that. I need to say that is my kid being pulled over.
Yeah.
We need to, if what was it that Elie Wiesel said?
Elie Wiesel said something to the effect of, if you can't love all children, then you can't authentically say you love your own children.
Right.
That's not an exact quote,
but it's something like that. I mean, that's where we are right now. I want to close with this.
We are interconnected.
I want to close with this poem that we read this week. We saw this in a podcast. I mean, in a blog, and I'll throw it up there so that you can see who it was, because it's what she wrote was beautiful. It was last year. Maya Angelou wrote this. She said, "Do the best you can until you know better. Then, when you know better, do better."
Yeah.
If you think about it, where we were, where I was as a Christian early on, what I thought faith was all about, and the Samaritan was all about, and I just thought, well, you just do good, and when you find people in need, you help them out. But I didn't have this systemic understanding of how I participated in a dysfunctional, oppressive reality that my own benefit, that my own life was grounded on.
Yeah.
And now I know better.
Yeah, we can't.
Now I know better.
That's no excuse anymore, because we do know better.
Yeah.
And unless we have completely dismissed this whole thing or stuck our head in the sand, we don't have an excuse anymore. We know better. And now is time that we do better.
And I think we are going to be doing better. I really do. I believe that we are at a tipping point in terms of a spiritual revolution. I really do believe that. And I say that because next week, of course, is our celebration of our
Independence Day.
Of our historical revolution as a country, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's our Independence Day. But I'm going to play around with this idea and suggest to you that let's celebrate that. But now with this understanding of shalom, I want to challenge us to think about celebrating an Interdependence Day. A way of seeing life, a spiritual revolution, a way of seeing us as more interdependent than independent. So let's join together next week, and we're going to begin a new series. It really picks up from this idea of shalom, and we're going to think about celebrating our interdependence.
Interdependence on yeah. one another.
Yeah. So
this has been wonderful. Thank you again for sharing it with us, these parables.
Bless you for this week. Yeah. Brad's got another amazing song he's going to come up with to close us out. And we'll just wish you shalom.
Shalom.